production funding for Ruckus has been provided by Fred and Lou Hartwig and viewers like you. Thank you.
Good evening. Welcome to Ruckus, that weekly food for thought fight over the news of the day and the trends of the times. I'm Mike Shannon. The Ruckettes join me shortly, and our topics tonight include the state of the state, the state of the union, and the future state of same-sex unions. But we start with our newsmaker interview, and joining me this week is Nancy Millard, Vice President and General Counsel, CBIZ Employee Services Division, and Board Chair of the Central Exchange in Kansas City. Our topic, the challenge of getting women into leadership roles. Nancy, welcome to the Ruckus program.
Thank you, Mike.
First of all, let me ask you about the Central Exchange. What is it, where is it, and what is it designed to do?
Central Exchange is a women's organization. In 2015, we are celebrating 35 years. We're very proud of that 35 years, started 35 years ago by 12 women who really wanted to find a place where women can connect, where we can really achieve what we want, and to transform into where we want to go. And so it's a women organization. It is located at 10th and Central. That's our original location many, many years ago. We have a second location out in Johnson County on College Boulevard in Knoll. And we're very pleased, Mike, to have just announced in our strategic planning process, we have said we need to look at the full metropolitan area, and we just made an announcement of an alliance with the Northland Chamber of Commerce and what we're going to do with being able to now go north.
And the Central Exchange is not just for women. Some people may think that, but that's not the case.
You know what, Mike, I really appreciate you. It is a women's organization, but not
exclusively
only women.
Yeah.
And in fact, our board of directors, which you know I chair the board of directors,
right,
has very, very important men on our board that really understand the business case and the mission that we are trying to promote. And therefore, not only is our membership for both men and women, but we're very pleased with the members on our board of directors that are men.
Obviously, you're in a leadership role, both at your business and in your civic life. What advice do you have? What tips would you offer, one or two, to women who want to be in leadership capacities?
You know, Mike, I know we only have a few minutes, and maybe you'll invite me back to have more discussion on that, because I am very vocal about this. I'm very passionate about this. But I would say over the period of time where I have been more and more engaged, both with Central Exchange, and then I was asked by our CEO and chairman of the board to build our women's program within CBIZ, CBIZ Women's Advantage, my thoughts have evolved, which I think you would hope that they would, into saying that for women, my primary advice for women that, first of all, I think we are all leaders every day. Mm-hmm. None of us are not. But to really advance our leadership positions, we need to own it. And what I mean by that is don't blame other people. Don't look to other sources to get you where you want to go. Own it. And I think that is a real empowering position to take, because then you're in control.
Well, I was intrigued by a statement in an article about you. You said women, I suppose men too, need mentors, but also women need sponsors.
Yes.
What's the distinction?
Lots of people have talked about this. It is a very important distinction. Quite frankly, I would say, just to talk about mentoring for a moment, Mike, I would say that to go to that informal peer-to-peer mentoring is a much better position if you're looking at mentoring. What is a sponsor? It is someone, I always say, that knows your weaknesses almost more than they know your strengths. They're willing to invest in saying, go for it. Make mistakes, take risks, take smart risks. And they're doing that because they know where you want to go, but they also know what's holding you back.
Well, don't you also say that sponsors are people who can kind of open the door
That's
for
right.
you?
That's right. Clearly, those individuals are in positions of, and I don't know if it's power as much as they're in positions that can make a true difference in your career path.
Are you concerned about these news stories that say there are no women elected statewide in Kansas this time, and there have been in the past, but there are women in strong leadership positions within the legislative branch, and the city council is going to perhaps have fewer women next term? Does that bother you? Is that a concern?
Well, you asked two questions. Does it bother me? Yes. Is it a concern? No, Mike, and let me tell you why. I don't think it's a toxic political environment. I don't think it's intentional. Again, going back to the fact that if we want to look at other problems, then we're blaming something else instead of ourselves. So I think it is, it's not a trend. I really see it more as it ebbs and flows. We have women, Central Exchange is doing this also in terms of understanding our role in advocacy. We are helping women to know that, again, we have to invest our time, our money, our talents in what we believe. And I think from an advocacy perspective, I think women going in and looking at running for government positions, whether it's at the state level with the information they're talking about with Kansas, as well as our city council in Kansas City, Missouri, I think it is just a matter of women saying, go for it.
Hey, can you give me like 10-second response to this question? You say, I speak as a person, not as a woman.
Oh, absolutely. I speak as a person, not a woman. But I'm very proud to be a woman. But I speak as a person.
I do hope you'll come back and see us again. It's a fascinating topic, and you're fun to talk to.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you very much.
That is Nancy Mellard, the board chair of the Central Exchange in Kansas City, Missouri. Now let's go over, meet the panel, and see if it's possible to start a ruckus. Yael Abahaka is an editorial writer at the Kansas City Star. Cynthia Wheeler is a communication strategist. Mary O'Halloran is a media and communications consultant, and attorney Steve Marakian is with the law firm of Wersch, Hobbs, and Marakian. Well, it's been a week since Kansas Governor Sam Brownback delivered his State of the State address and offered several controversial proposals still being mulled by supporters and mauled by opponents. The governor wants to revise the school finance formula, continue the move to zero income tax, change the way the state Supreme Court justices are selected, and change the dates for local elections. All this and more leads political columnist Steve Kraske to observe that the notion that he, Brownback, now ranks as Kansas' most consequential governor becomes something to ponder. So let's ponder for a while and start with you, Cynthia. Ponder about the governor and
ponder
his consequences.
And ponder, I did, and his consequences, I hate to admit this, but yes, he is. And I'd like to say from my liberal position, indirectly, I find his supercilious leadership style to be kind of hard to stomach. And the changes that he has implemented with his hypothesis that no taxes will reap a great, great community have certainly failed.
Do you see nothing beneficial or consequential in a positive way from the Brownback administration?
Not at all. Not at all. Look at the two downgrades from Moody to a Standard and Poor, a change in the middle class on the Kansas side, no jobs. Let's talk about Medicaid, Medicare, and the changes he made there, putting that into the hand of the private sector. Are we really saving money in Kansas when you have private companies who are reaping a profit, but yet the trickle down is the individual who's supposed to be receiving those services, whether they're disabled or whether they're suffering, you know, some sort of minor setback? Money is sitting in the hands of corporations, not in the people in the state of Kansas.
Well, Governor Brownback says he wants to revise the state school finance formula because no one understands it. And I think perhaps that's true, Yael.
It could be, except his block grant proposal is ununderstandable as well right now, because it's going to be complicated as well. School districts are different. You know, Johnson County is different from Meade and Liberal and Hugoton and all those places. So there will be some kind of complication in the block grant as well. But, you know, the overall point is I've spent a fair amount of time criticizing the governor, who I would say if Steve had written he's been the most destructive governor in history, that'd be close but not true, because he's definitely not there yet. But the guy who basically did hurt the budget with these tax cuts is now taxed with repairing it. The sin taxes are an idea. The idea of having a different kind of school formula, it makes some sense. Let's look at other states and see where it's worked, and, you know, maybe we can improve it and do a better job of educating kids. And that's the one thing I disagree with Cynthia on. I do think, yes, he's done something positive, which is let's look at government a little bit different way. I'm always open to that.
But the bad thing
is his income tax cut was so poorly thought out, it's hurting everything else he's done.
Does not have to be positive.
The word consequential does not mean positive, actually.
I pointed that out in the note I sent to all of you, I believe.
If I could add to what Cynthia said, he's been radically consequential. And, you know, I really think that this is where he wants to be. I think he actually has achieved success in his own mind. He is so radically right in terms of taxes and income. He wanted to cause budgetary chaos so as to be able to just slice through state government and radically not only reduce its size, but begin the movement toward completely privatizing K through 12 education in the state of Kansas. He is well on his way. There's never been a more powerful governor. And the next step for him is to take control of the Supreme Court, which he, and if the lawyers of the state don't step forward, he's well on his way to do that.
On that topic, Steve, the governor suggests that perhaps we should appoint judges to the Kansas Supreme Court the way we appoint justices to the U.S. Supreme Court. President makes a nomination, and it's either confirmed or denied by the Senate.
Yeah, and there's that's.
Is that a good idea?
Well, it's certainly not a bad idea. I like the current plan personally, but
that's the so-called Missouri plan.
But
isn't it?
But the point you just made is exactly the point that that Brownback and his supporters make, is that this is the way we do it with the U.S. Supreme Court. This is the way many other states do it. It's clearly not a either radical or ridiculous plan. I just like our current plan better. But it's certainly, you know, in Missouri, the governor appoints judges in Missouri. A panel suggests, and then the governor appoints. This is not terribly different from what Brownback is proposing.
Brownback's other suggestion would be to have the state Supreme Court judges elected popularly.
Yeah, I don't like that idea.
I don't
idea.
Like that either.
No, and I don't think that will ever pass. I hope it doesn't. Texas and some other states elect all their judges. I think it's a very bad idea. I don't like the fact that Missouri elects judges in many of the rural counties.
I want to wrap this up with a question for you, Steve, and I'll read a quote from the Kansas City Star, the attorney for the plaintiffs in the school finance suit, Alan Roop. He says Brownback wants to rewrite the formula to hold down state spending. Quote, the legislature cannot make decisions solely based on what the state can afford. What do you make decisions based on?
He's an advocate, and he's a very good lawyer and advocate, but part of the problem is, and I think Yale has nailed it here, is that there are lots of different kinds of formula that you can come up with, and many states have them. The notion, however, that Kansas education, or that we tie per student funding to education results, is simply not proven, and all you have to do is look at the states in the union who have the highest per capita and the states that have the lowest, and it's an almost an inverse.
Well, that's what
it's almost inverse in terms of the actual performance. So, you know, they're going to come up with something, and it'll work.
All right, we have to move ahead. The U.S. Constitution says the president must, from time to time, report to Congress about the state of the union. It doesn't have to be a speech. It could just be a document. But since Woodrow Wilson, every president, with the exception of Hoover, has chosen to speak, especially since the advent of radio and television. This past Tuesday was no exception, and Barack Obama, the 44th president, gave the now Republican-controlled Congress his assessment of the state of the union.
America, for all that we have endured, for all the grit and hard work required to come back, for all the tasks that lie ahead, know this: the shadow of crisis has passed, and the state of the union is strong.
So, if you could write the headline from the president's speech, what would it be and why, Mary?
Well, I think his best statement was, are we going to accept an economy where a few people do spectacularly well, or are we going to insist on an economy where everyone moves ahead if they're willing to do the work? And that was sort of an introduction to his really important new statement and policy on free community college for everyone who wants to do the work and keep their grades up. I thought that was the heart and soul of the middle class economics, which is what this speech was about. In addition to saying the page is turned, the new day is here, now off to Lawrence, and giving a wonderful speech out there. I thought it was the president's best State of the Union. I agree with David Brooks on that. It was full of energy and excitement. He was liberated, kind of unleashed from, from elections, from the recession that was just killing us.
All right, couldn't quickly around the table, headline from the speech, Yale.
Oh, I think the point that he has to make and continue to make, and Democrats need to make for that matter, is that the economy is back. We've been having so many years hearing how bad the economy is, that the economy is much stronger. Certainly the inequality thing is really bad. But don't let it be fooled. The economy is much stronger.
Quick headline, Cynthia.
Informative, liberating, directive, decisive, distinctly Obama.
Steve.
Well, I thought it was a bizarre and combative speech. Here's my headline. Here's my headline. Delusion, deception, and division. Obama vows to veto.
I thought you would say everything old is new again. While gay marriage is still banned by constitutional amendments in both Missouri and Kansas, same-sex couples are nonetheless being married legally in Kansas City and in other parts of both states. That became possible because of rulings by federal appeals courts overturning state decisions. But some appellate courts have upheld state bans on same-sex marriage. So now the U.S. Supreme Court is going to step in and decide what's to happen. And Steve, what do you think the verdict is going to be?
Well, this is a really tough one because the way the court has split this into two issues really doesn't bode well. And it disappoints me that they've done this. And I think what they've done is this. There is a group on the court, four, who will clearly say that the 14th Amendment requires states or prohibits states from banning same-sex marriage. There's no question about that. That group of four, however, is very concerned that the others, that they won't get Kennedy's vote for the fifth vote. So they're very concerned. So they wanted the second issue, which is, okay, even if we don't get that, let's make sure that marriages that have already been consummated will be valid.
Let me just state the two questions.
What the court will do.
Let me state the two questions as I understand them. First, may states prohibit same-sex marriage? And second, can states refuse to recognize these marriages that were performed legally elsewhere?
Right.
Can they have yes and no as answers?
Yeah, and I don't want to see the court do that. Mm-hmm. I think the state should come down, the court should come down and side with liberty issues and say that same-sex marriage is okay. I think they should do that and end the debate. What I'm afraid they're going to do is they're going to get a 5-4 vote saying same-sex marriage is not okay nationally, or you know, that states have the right to refuse
gay marriage.
But they're going to throw the bone to the other side by saying, well, in states where you are married, that's got to be recognized everywhere. And I don't like that, but I'm afraid the court's going to do it.
You know what that'll do? That will then kick off 20 years of abortion-type debates. Of a state going, well, you know, blah, blah, blah. And it'll so they'll put up new restrictions or you know, once a real conservative gets in there. So I agree with you. I do think they will. I mean, I'm hoping, that they go ahead and just say.
And, Mary, a lot of people, a lot of analysts think the court will say that states can't deny gay marriage.
And really, if you want to understand this question with regard to the Supreme Court, read Justice Kennedy's decision in the Defense of Marriage Act decision, mm-hmm. where he really did unleash this beautiful argument that denying any American person the right to marry the person they love is a demeaning, undignified attack on their personhood as individual people. And under the United States, under the law, that ought to be the protection that people have. Justice Kennedy is, I think, affected more by the tone of what's going on in the country, and maybe even the Pope. You know, there are 9 Catholics on the court, and the Pope is a little less angry about black
people. Very quickly,
Steve. Here's the concern. Mary's right about Justice Kennedy. The problem is, Kennedy is also one of those who might very well say, I think that every state should do this, but it's up to the states. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And mm-hmm. then it comes down to, okay, states will decide, but they'll also say, if you're married, it's got to be recognized. Yeah. That's a bad decision.
Justice Kennedy appointed by Ronald Reagan, by the way. 40 candidates will turn up on the primary ballot in April for the Kansas City, Missouri City Council. All 12 council positions and the mayor's office are up for election. Mayor Sly James is expected to have an easy run. He faces 2 candidates, one relatively unknown, the other, Clay Chastain, known too well. Some familiar names are back: Catherine Shields, Teresa Lohr, Ken Baucus, Jolie Justice, just to name a few. Some incumbents will be up for a second term. Other incumbents will be leaving. So, Yale, from your experienced vantage point, what is your overall assessment of the potential council field?
Oh, I think it is a good field. You'll probably have several incumbents coming back. Obviously, the mayor is going to be reelected. There's no doubt about that. So, you know, he'll have a few experienced people to work with. But the exciting part is, this is like the 7th 4-year term that I've covered here, and it's really interesting to see what the new people you know, their vision, what they can do.
Who was the first mayor you covered? Berkeley?
Berkeley. The first Jewish mayor, the first black mayor, the first woman mayor, and the first crazy mayor upon council.
Who did you support in that Funkhauser race?
Mark was a great mayor until about the second day into his term when his wife took over.
Yeah.
Okay, but looking ahead,
yeah.
The best thing is that a number of the people who are running, I mean, Jolie Justice is one example. But
she was a state legislator.
State legislator,
right?
But running against John Piero, who has served on several different city committees. So that's two experienced people in that one race. There are a number of other races where there are people who have been on the Public Improvement Advisory Committee, which so they know a little bit about money. There are several. There's one guy who, Jay Hodges, who worked on more or less with James's staff. So, I mean, he's kind of in sync with what goes on at City Hall. So there are all these different strengths, what I would say. I think at the end of the day, you're going to have a council that is going to have actually probably a pretty experienced bunch that hadn't been on the council before, but here's the thing, the diversity is going to be good. And I don't just mean black-white, I mean the diversity of experience, which in my look at the council is usually good, and especially if you're not going to get into this thing where you have people who, oh, I'm going to go off and try to do my own little thing. No, that's not how Kansas City advances. Time after time after time, we've seen that when you have 6, 7, or 8 council members working together with the mayor, that's when the downtown plan gets done. That's when streetcar gets done. That's when good things get done.
And this council will have some major issues to deal with. Streetcars among them.
Yeah, streetcar expansion is definitely among them.
KCI.
The KCI thing there, the Kemper Arena. Those are the big ones. Well, but the other one is the budget, police and public safety.
Yeah, before we move on quickly, how did Chastain become eligible to run for mayor?
Well, he put in enough signatures, but I did check with the Citizens Association because they're doing their interviews this week. And unfortunately, Clay will not be able to make it because he's living in his current home in Virginia. So, you know, he's running for mayor, but he's actually not in Kansas City.
All right, Mary?
If I could, I'd really just like to just veer a little bit off of the direct question and say that I have the deepest admiration for something, lots of things about Kansas City, but one of them is this period of time every 2 years when, and more importantly, every 4 years in the mayor's sense, when this really incredibly strong democratic process rolls itself out. I think that you could, if you were a citizen of Kansas City, start tomorrow night or tonight and go out and participate in a public forum just about every night, any place across. And you could go to great big fancy ones, you can go to neighborhoods. Every citizen will have the right to ask, stand up and speak out and ask Sly James a question or ask any one of the candidates for council. And I do agree with Yale that there's a good mix of experience because, boy, are we losing some great people. Jan Markison, Cindy Serco, others, of course, Melba Curls. Point is, the citizen involvement in this is the best in the nation. I don't have any doubts about that.
Right.
It's so impressive.
Cynthia, will you be out every night going to these public?
I don't think I will be out every night going to the public.
But regularly.
Very regularly, I'm interested. We've got a great group of people.
We do.
And it's
right.
going to be fun to watch.
It is time now for Roast and Toast, where the Ruckheads say yay or nay to people and events in the news. And we start this evening with Cynthia.
Okay, I'm going to toast Mr. Dave Helling. And the reason I'm doing that is I've been out of town for quite a while and happened to catch his last two articles, and he helped me find faith in the notion that journalism is alive and well, and that when it comes to reporting or giving us, the reader, the opportunity to draw our own conclusions, his last two articles did that for me, and I hope they did it for the rest.
My roast is for the Marxist mountain of flab, Michael Moore, for his sniping at the movie American Sniper for portraying Chris Kyle as a hero. Kyle was a true hero who, unlike Moore, actually served with honor and saved the lives of hundreds of American soldiers. At a time when the Obama Justice Department is prosecuting another American hero, David Petraeus, but won't prosecute an American deserter, Bo Bergdahl, Moore's attack on the memory of Chris Kyle is both boorish and typical of the America-hating far left.
Well, this is a toast to groups such as Forward Kansas City Citizen Association and others that have these forums that you can go to and listen to the candidates. Now, remember, this year, you don't vote until April for the primary, so there's plenty of time to get to know some of the people. I think some of the races will be close, and it's not Democrat versus Republican. They're actually talking about issues that matter to you from a financial standpoint, from a neighborhood standpoint. That's a great thing about the city elections.
My toast for the life and the legacy of the Reverend Nelson Fuzzy Thompson. I know that he has been toasted in his memory, still very fresh in everybody's mind from his death 2 weeks ago, and Martin Luther King celebration going on at the same time. Nelson Thompson was so welcoming to everyone. He was the leader of the African American civil rights movement in this, one of the leaders, but he was welcoming to everyone in that movement, including myself, and I learned a great deal from him. I am grateful to him for the times where he stood up and spoke out when nobody else could.
And finally, here's a toast to the cable channel of the Unified Government of Kansas City, Kansas, and Wyandotte County. Previously, I roasted the channel twice, and I would say I was generous in my criticism. In recent months, however, the channel has improved impressively. The information it provides is now important. The graphics are good. The audio and video crisp and clear. It is a real improvement and certainly deserving of a thank you from this appreciative resident. And that is Ruckus for this week. We're back next Thursday at 7 on behalf of the panel this week, Yael, Cynthia, Mary, and Steve, and all the crew that helps us put this program together. I'm Mike Shannon saying thanks very much for joining us. See you next Thursday at 7, and good night.